the Executive Secretary of the ECA, Dr. Carlos Lopez. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here. My name is Omar Benyeda. I'm the publisher at ICE Publications, publishers of African Business Magazine, amongst others. We're here today for, I think, the final panel. Since I've met Dr. Lopez about 3 years ago, the word transformation has been at the tip of his tongue. And I think now we've all bought the concept of transformational growth. Today, really, we want to look at the macroeconomic frameworks to drive this structural transformation that we're talking about. So we're going to start with some welcome remarks and an opening statement by Dr. Lopez, following by a keynote address by His Excellency, Mr. Matata Ponyo. I haven't met Mr. Matata Ponyo, but we've written about him extensively in our magazines. For the past couple of years, without being undiplomatic, but he's been Mr. DRC internationally, going and carrying the DRC flag. Dr. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, a few years ago, wrote a book called Reforming the Unreformable. And I think that the DRC challenge has possibly been a bigger one than the one in Nigeria. And Mr. Matata Ponyo has been at the forefront of this transformational change in the sleeping giant. He really has been a driving force behind transforming the country, including the macroeconomic framework within his country. So we're looking forward to the keynote address. Then we're going to have a presentation of the report by Mr. Adam, who's a director at the ECA, followed by some comments from our panelists in terms of what's been presented today. And then we'll open it up to any questions to the panelists and our keynote addressee. So we'll start with Dr. Lopez. Thank you.
Thank you, Omar. It's really a pleasure to have you in that role. You excel in all roles that you play, but this one is particularly charming. I'm very happy to be here in the company of the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister, as it has been ably described by Omar just now, is a true reformer, and we are very proud that he has been able to find the time of actually writing about it, and his book, Pour un Congo émergent, for Emerging Congo, will be distributed to the lucky ones. So we don't have copies for everybody, but those who read French will have a preference because the book is in French. And I was very pleased to, as I said, and honored to do the preface of the book, because it's really a good testimony of the need for us to tackle macroeconomic challenges with an open eye and with a very smart approach. And some of the panelists, I know I have here, for instance, Minister Niuai, will just confirm what is possible to do if you are bold. And I think both our panelists from my right, Yao, because he has been one of the champions of economic transformation and its definition, and also Nagla, that this morning was just presenting us some of the interesting experiments going on in Egypt, will complete what is promising to be a very interesting discussion. And of course, my colleague Adam is going to present a book to you, actually a report, which is this one, on macroeconomic policy and structural transformation of African economies, because we have been talking about structural transformation. You have to underpin it with a very specific number of recommendations when it comes to macroeconomic policy. And we believe that we have earned the space to be a bit bold about macroeconomic frameworks and not just follow what comes from a very pleasant city called Washington, D.C. So I'm really glad to welcome you to Addis and to ECA in this side event, and I hope you will enjoy. The last two decades or so have seen African economies, as we know, register impressive growth, and I think a number of factors, including improved economic governance and macroeconomic management, are definitely part of that story. However, the continent's growth has recently moderated due to a number of headwinds emanating from commodity price and exchange rate volatilities, global economic slowdown, and financial market turmoil. Africa's real GDP growth is expected to increase to about 4.3% this year and 4.4% in the next year, according to our projections. But the performance of last year didn't make the 4%, so in our estimates, 3.7%. There is a tendency for the continent to grow rapidly, yet transform slowly, making it vulnerable to such headwinds. To sustain the positive socioeconomic outcomes from the recent growth, African countries must revisit the current development models and reap benefits that result from their structural transformation processes. But what do we mean by structural transformation, and why has it been slow to happen in Africa? Well, structural transformation in our minds is characterized by a rise on productivity as well as an increase in the relative contribution of industry to GDP, rural-urban shifts and demographic transition from high fertility, high mortality to low fertility, low mortality scenarios. In Agenda 2063 of the African Union, it says that the Africa that we want is one that is inclusive, sustainable, integrated, politically united, and one that is deepening a culture of good governance, democratic values, gender equality, respect for human rights, justice and rule of law, peace and security, amongst many other aspirations. There are valid grounds to hope that Africa will be the next investment destination of choice. In fact, you know, according to Ernst & Young, it's already the second. A number of emerging countries have intensified their engagement with the continent, as well as with specific African countries, to tap into the huge potential characterized by abundant natural resources and youthful population. Indeed, both foreign and domestic investments have risen considerably. Optimizing the opportunities at
et la mise en œuvre de politiques saines et cohérentes. Ces cadres doivent s'ancrer sur trois éléments principaux si nous tenons à faire des changements réels. Il s'agit d'une base humaine forte, une gestion macroéconomique saine et des politiques Ces politiques macroéconomiques doivent permettre de résoudre les problèmes de déconnexion qui existent entre les ambitions à long terme et la réalité. Nous pensons que ceci ne pourrait se réaliser que quand des politiques macroéconomiques fortes et saines seront élaborées et mises en œuvre dans le cadre d'un système global. Ce cadre de planification a besoin d'un ensemble de politiques économiques et d'institutions solides pour que la transformation structurelle produise les résultats escomptés. Pour illustrer les liens entre les exigences à court et à long terme d'un cadre macroéconomique sain, nous savons que les politiques fiscales sont très importantes. Par exemple, elles peuvent permettre de renouer la confiance entre le secteur public et le secteur privé, permettre d'améliorer la fourniture de services de qualité et aussi permettre d'améliorer les conditions de vie des populations. Les politiques fiscales peuvent permettre de générer l'appropriation des stratégies nationales à travers des financements nationaux appropriés et des arrangements institutionnels qui encouragent la participation. La gestion financière effective, la lutte contre les fléaux tels que la corruption et les flux financiers illicites, toutes choses qui permettraient de mobiliser davantage de ressources et devraient figurer au centre des politiques fiscales africaines. Le succès dans ces différents points permettra de légitimer les activités fiscales de l'État. Pour terminer, des politiques fiscales bien exécutées impliquerait, n'est-ce pas, une croissance des économies africaines avec un régime fiscal favorable pour les entreprises nationales et multinationales. Je suis heureux que cette semaine, nous avons lancé un rapport qui a été signé par les pays africains sur les relations bilatérales et multilatérales à cet égard. Les politiques macroéconomiques et de développement sont très importantes pour garantir le bon fonctionnement du système monétaire qui soutient la transformation des économies. Et dans le contexte africain, les politiques monétaires ne doivent pas nécessairement être impulsées par des outils conventionnels tels que les cibles d'inflation dont nous avons parlé ce matin dans le cadre de la réunion avec les gouverneurs d'Afrique centrale. À notre avis, il faudrait compter sur la flexibilité et tenir compte des cadres particuliers de chaque pays. Par exemple, en termes de politique de change, il serait important de poursuivre une politique de change qui permet de garantir une stabilité à long terme. La priorité à cet effet devrait permettre de passer des cibles d'inflation à d'autres cibles qui permettent à l'Afrique de créer les emplois dont elle a besoin. Les gouvernements ont un rôle à jouer dans la mise en place d'institutions solides et nous comptons sur eux pour jouer ce rôle. Au contraire, au cours des années 60, 70 et 80, les gouvernements n'avaient pas véritablement joué ce rôle et s'étaient laissés influencer par le marché. L'Afrique a besoin d'une gouvernance saine qui s'appuie sur des cadres économiques bien définis. L'Afrique doit compter sur ses citoyens qui continuent de vivre dans la pauvreté et de vivre d'autres problèmes. Compte tenu du rôle des politiques macroéconomiques, nous, au niveau de la CEA, avons décidé d'organiser cet événement parallèle avec pour objectif discuter la manière dont l'Afrique peut élaborer des cadres de politique macroéconomique qui impulseront la transformation. Et à cet égard, nous sommes extrêmement heureux d'avoir avec nous Son Excellence Monsieur le Premier ministre de la RDC, Monsieur Augustin Matata Ponyo, qui va partager avec nous ses réflexions sur cette question. Surtout que entre 2010 et 2013, ils ont enregistré une croissance de 7,3% et même plus. résultat d'une politique macroéconomique bien pensée et bien exécutée. Les résultats de cette réunion vont permettre à nos décideurs de réorienter leur réflexion sur les politiques macroéconomiques nécessaires pour la transformation structurelle durable de l'Afrique et son développement. Je vous remercie.
Merci, Dr. Lopez. Nous avons un rapport et vous avez évoqué un certain nombre de questions. Et notre orateur principal, Son Excellence, Monsieur le Ministre Matata, vous avez la parole.
I would like to thank the organizers, the African Union Commission, the Economic Commission for Africa, for having honored me with an invitation to attend this important meeting. It gives me the opportunity to address the new macroeconomic frameworks for Africa. I also wish to extend my gratitude to the Ethiopian authorities for the warm welcome extended to me since I got here. I feel all the more honored considering that the current global economic context requires that we as leaders be more innovative in order to provide our economies with real protection against external shocks. Otherwise, such shocks might undermine performance achieved by the African continent in recent years. They will diminish Africa's capacity to consolidate inclusive growth in the continent as a whole. Whereas our struggle for drastic poverty reduction is subject to our capacity to innovate. In fact, considering various external shocks due to what happens within the world market, especially negative fluctuations of commodity prices and the slowdown in the Chinese economy, prospects for growth throughout the continent are low, from an average of 6% of annual growth since 2000. Growth forecasts in sub-Saharan Africa have dropped to 3.5% in 2015, 4% in 2016, and 4.7% in 2017, according to the International Monetary Fund. Since 2002, under the leadership of the President of the Republic and Head of State, His Excellency Joseph Kabila Kabange, the Democratic Republic of Congo has, renewed or achieved its growth curve, and it is now on the upward trend, thanks to support from the international community, of course. Such growth that I've always achieved from 2002 to 2015 has basically been driven by extractive industries, agriculture, construction, telecommunications, and trade. As for the expenditure, there has been an increase in the real GDP, and this arises from the proper performance of private investment and public investment. Growth is limited in terms of job creation and well-paying jobs and proper living conditions. The mining sector, which is the main basis for such growth, produces or generates low added value and remains subject to world market trends, world market ups and downs. Now, beyond these achievements that have been made by the DRC in recent years and the prospects for sustained growth on the short, medium, and long term, its economy remains less or hardly diversified and vulnerable to external shocks. The structural transformation remains the country's major challenge. And to that end, all the structural constraints inhibiting the growth of the private sector, all these need to be unlocked to ensure increased production and an enhanced economic competitiveness. Now, this analysis is at the basis of the policy decisions made by the DRC government, which I am leading since April 2012 under the leadership of the President of the Republic. My address this evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, will focus on the pillars of the Congolese exceptional economic recovery in recent years. It will focus on its remarkable and unquestionable awakening and on the resilience of its economy in dealing with external shocks, as well as our will to safeguard the achievements and further consolidate them. Now, to enable me to develop, to expound on these ideas, I will in turn focus on 3 points. First, I'll provide the details on the macroeconomic situation of the DRC in the recent years. Secondly, I will share with you the social impact of the DRC economic achievements. And thirdly, I will provide the explanation for such performances. Many experts in the field of economics have referred to the achievements of our economy during these last years as tremendous and impressive, especially when it is considered that this occurs in fairly difficult political and security context. The Vice President of the World Bank, Makhtar Diop, said he was impressed to see how robust the DRC growth was, despite the large extent of fiscal adjustment, which has resulted in limitations of overall demand and the remarkable macroeconomic framework. That aside, the IMF Deputy Managing Director, David Lipton, the President of the African Development Bank, my dear Adesina, and my dear friend is the Executive Secretary of the UN Economic Commission for Africa, Carlos Lopez, my friend here who is present, and others who have gone through Kinshasa have referred to these achievements as a success story. Indeed, from close to 10,000%, let me repeat, 10,000% in 1994, exceeding the then world record, national inflation, that is the Congolese level of inflation, dropped to 0.8% in 2015. That's last year. That's a drop of about 11,200. From less than 14% in 1993, the unusual depletion in wealth, the growth of the GDP of DRC has dropped from minus 14% to 9.5% in 2014, which is one of the highest in the world. The DRC, by the end of 2015, with a growth rate is set at 7.7%, dropped to 5%, which is the sub-Saharan Africa rate. In terms of exchange rates, local currency appreciated only by 0.4% versus a 99.6% depreciation in 1994. Ladies and gentlemen, what has DRC done since 2002 so as to achieve the performances that I've just briefly alluded to? Now, to explain that performance since 2011, that would require that I answer, on the whole, the following three questions. The first one. One, how do we explain the fact that from a hyperinflation, we have speedily transited to a low and stable inflation, whereas, from the experience of several other countries, evidence does point to the fact that usually after hyperinflation, inflation remains relatively high and volatile. Number two, How do we match the high economic growth rate, nearly 8% annual average, with a low inflation, whereas several knowledgeable observers, in fact, some experts, academicians, are of the view that only a moderate level of inflation on the average of 5 to 20% per year can drive growth? Third question, finally, how do we explain the Congolese growth resilience in a gloomy international environment while other African countries are experiencing a different situation? Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, the cornerstone of my submission can be summarized as follows. In a situation of hyperinflation coupled with recession, fiscal policy based on the allocating of resources towards productive jobs to the detriment of speculative utilizations would enable us to overcome both inflation and recession. So that is the basic hypothesis from which I will try to expound further. Hence, to answer to that question, I will use the theoretical model of aggregate demand, known as AD, and aggregated supply, AS. The line DA that you have stands for the sum of government expenditure, households, companies, and net exports. As for line OA, it provides information on the quantity of goods and services supplied by companies on the market. As figure 1A shows, adjustment by overall demand focuses on the macroeconomic stabilization and aims at fighting inflation in order to prepare the economy to resume growth on a long-term basis. If figure 1A, zero, if you look at that figure, one can see that the drop in the aggregated demand moves from DAO to DA1. This is very important to enable you to follow on this graph, because the prices and production drop as a result, whereas unemployment, which appears on the other figure with the Phillips curve, as shown on figure 1A, unemployment is on the increase with a drop in demand. In order to act on inflation without undermining economic growth, the tightening of demand should be or should result from the drop in speculative demand and the restructuring of public expenditure, and this is what appears in figure 1B. Now, though if efforts are combined to broaden the fiscal space and ensure a better reimbursement of public expenditure, especially in terms of capital, as they impact on production capacity and on prices, thanks to low transaction costs, stabilization efforts might not strengthen unemployment. For instance, higher capital expenditure through a multiplier effect leads to growth in demand, and through an accelerator or a catalyst effect increases supply, and that's what appears under figure 1B, as you would see on the graph. Consequently, with a drop in inflation, there is not an automatic increase in unemployment, as you would see again on the graph before you. So that exactly is what happened in the particular case of the Democratic Republic of Congo, which was affected by both inflation and a drop in production. In fact, counterproductive and speculative expenditure and loan are actually not affected by their subject. They are a result of easy money and characterized by readily finding themselves on the exchange market as soon as they are paid. Now, in that regard, the government was required to ensure that there is a speedy reimbursement of public expenditure by stopping the annuitant that is paying on an annual basis, Therefore, we need her to carry out the reforms. And I will make mention of a number of these reforms. One, the increased use of banking for the payments of any dues from the government, whether they are applied to public administration, the army, the police, etc., so as to avoid embezzlement of wages that often fuel foreign exchange markets. Secondly, we try to ensure the strict management of the domestic debt in order to prevent reimbursement of unjustified debts which are speculative in nature. Thirdly, we generalize the public procurement, for instance, in the case of any public contracts, we wanted to ensure that such payments are competitive, or bids are competitive, and we also sought to ensure financial and physical work implementation coherence. Finally, priority was extended to expenses related to or intended to enhance human capital in the area, field of education, in the field of health, physical capital in terms of in the field of infrastructures, communication, and energy infrastructure, in order to act on production capacity and prices. To that end, related measures have made it possible for us to fight against inflation and recession. Reforms coupled with the demand recovery through quality expenditure gave way to economic growth recovery with a controlled level of inflation. So that's the price we had to pay, and it appears in the graph before you. In order to understand how relevant these measures are, it is worth comparing figures 2A and 2B. In 2A, only the aggregated demand line moves, while in the second figure or graph, 2B, the aggregated supply curve pivots to the initial balance point. The reform effects, which allows the government to expand its fiscal space and to improve its expenditure quality, is a reason for that slope change. For instance, and for the record, the Democratic Republic of Congo was selected among the 10 world best reforming countries in the 2015 Doing Business Report. Capital expenditure increase resulting from procurement, as indicated earlier, does have an effect both on demand and supply, and that is why there is this shift from OA line towards the right, as you would see in figure 2.B1, and the Phillips curve towards the left, which you would find on figure 2.B2. Hence, the inflation slowdown is not associated with increase in unemployment. The level has remained at CH0, so there hasn't been any increase in unemployment. When compared to what appears under 1A, we notice that inflation is more acute here, and this is due to the fact that the increase in supply brings about a drop in prices in the market for goods and services. To avoid sinking the economy, or for the economy sinking into a stabilization and recession cycle, the government has taken parallel measures to stimulate supply. In fact, from 2002, an infrastructure reconstruction program has been put in place, and a series of key reforms have been launched in order to free the growth potential, namely through the promulgation of a new investment code and a new mining code. And it is within that framework that a partnership has been signed with mining companies to enable activity recovery in the sector in order to boost growth. These measures, coupled with the end of hyperinflation, have enabled the DRC's economy to resume growth, as it appears on figure 1B. Besides, reforms have been undertaken to expand the tax space and to improve on the quality of public expenditure. For instance, we have a new bureau on public finances. There is a new law on the value-added tax. which came into force in August 2010. There's a new customs code promulgated in June 2010, the new procurement code, April 2010. Then there is a submission of instruments pertaining to OHADA Treaty, July 2012. We've ratified the New York Convention on the Recognition and Enforcement of Foreign Arbitral Awards in 2015, etc. So several reforms have been introduced. Between 2001 and 2011, revenue has moved from 212.5 billion per year to more than 3.105,3 billion Congolese francs. That is 42 times the amount. And more recently, revenue has nearly been multiplied by two, moving from 2,462.1 billion in 2011 to 4,664.2 billion Congolese francs in 2014. The capital expenditure, the share of which is in the total budget, was only of 2.5% in 2001, has reached 12.6% in 2011. Table 2 appears before you. How did the Democratic Republic of Congo manage to consolidate macroeconomic stability, which is deemed to be exceptional? The main reason is the end of the dominance of budget implementation. This is due to lower returns to the government since 2010, which enabled the government to overcome volatile inflation and to enhance stability.
Donc, il n'y a plus depuis 2010.
Consequently, there is no printing of money. The government has made readjustment, namely regarding improvement of expenditure, which has significantly contributed to economic growth, leading to low inflation and strong growth. Briefly, this is the explanation to the economic, the macroeconomic achievements of my country. It is worth noting that the extent of budget adjustment has benefited from a prudent monetary policy. How the DRC built its resilience within the context of hostile international environment. Since 2011 to date, explanate factors that affect demand as well as overall supply. From the supply standpoint, what has been done? Infrastructure. This has to do with the infrastructure work that we have done and the major works. Indeed, the road infrastructure rehabilitation works, some of which were not motorable for 30 years, made it possible to open up the hinterland of the country and made it possible to cut products, particularly agricultural products from the rural areas, thus bringing down the cost of transaction. These works have increased goods and service supplies, which with a significant price drop. We have started agricultural campaign within the whole country. We have also the recovery of the agricultural sector and a presidential agribusiness structure, the implementation of agribusiness parks, of which Bukango Lanzo is the pilot activity. For example, the few months once infrastructure works were completed, DAIPN and Bukanga L will produce together 550 tons of vegetables. Considerable work has also been done in other sectors, but let me also focus your attention on the natural resources sector that we all know. aware of the stake of improvement of natural resources sector and given a presidential commitment, the government has made sustained efforts to fight fraud and illegal mining, put in place robust and bold reforms, improve governance, public mining companies management by clarifying asset disposal rules, and finally restore the sanctions system for the guilty to discourage fraud. The result is that DRC in July 1994 was elevated to the rank of EITI. It was complimented and honored in March 2016 at Lima, Peru for its efforts and performance in fighting for good governance. As you can see, the diversification of the DRC economy is bearing fruits with progressive diminution in the contribution of natural resources in our revenue, particularly in the tertiary sector such as transport and telecommunication. Ladies and gentlemen, invited guests, we have spoken about the support of the monetary policy to the budgetary adjustment efforts. It's important to say that the government has implemented a floating rate. The central bank intervenes where necessary to stabilize the exchange rate. The graph which comes shows how inflation and growth have the trend over the past few years. What has characterized us in 1994, as you can see on the growth, we went to moderate rate of inflation all the way to a very low and controlled inflation growth. From negative economic growth, as you can see in 1994 in figure 3.2, we moved on to a moderate growth, but also to high growth, and due to a number of policies between 2005 and 2010, the growth went to 5.8. This gave credibility to the policies and stabilized the exchange rates. In 2015, as I said, inflation came down to 0.8%. In spite of the fall of commodity prices, with the an improvement in the economic situation. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, it is important to indicate that since the DRC got in its independence in 1960, the DRC have had three programs with the IMF, but the performance that we are achieve now are higher than when we were having the programs of the IMF, DRC is in partnership with the IMF, with the ADB, as well as the World Bank and other bilateral and multilateral partners. It is, however, important to indicate that this growth has been achieved at a time that we did not have any program with the IMF. What then is the impact on our social sectors? Is the economic growth inclusive? Is it distributed? Efforts have been made by our government with commitment and determination to ensure that resilience would impact a human development index. Experience of resilience has shown that continued human development can be sustained even in difficult context with political and economic instability. despite the GDP high cumulative decrease of more than 50% during the 1990-2000 decade, poverty incidence has dropped from 80% to 71.3%, mitigating the Human Development Index, which dropped from 0.356 to 0.329. The table you have shows this sufficiently. The second experience of resilience indicates that political and security stability, ambitious ones, makes it possible to makes it possible to reverse the trend and to consolidate human development in the country. During the signing of the Millennium Declaration, the government under Kabila made remarkable effort during the period of 2000-2015 period of his to implement his development agenda. The bold reform program started in all sectors has made it possible to create conducive conditions to appropriate conditions, enabling conditions to accelerate human development. The table you have clearly indicates this. Allow me, ladies and gentlemen, and distinguished guests, to focus a bit on the issue of government, since the government has made education its absolute priority. This sector is key and shows how committed the government is to ensure intensive and rapid human progress for the Congolese youth. In addition to the financial measures referred to, several others have been implemented in this sector. This has to do with gradual generalization of free primary school education through the government funding of school fees, which used to be paid. This includes a refurbishing of deteriorating of school infrastructure, equipment destroyed following the armed conflict, the initial training reforms for teachers, monitoring, evaluation of learning experience. For all these actions, and to be conclusive, a permanent dialogue is maintained between all education partners, donors, and civil society through thematic group on education. This is how the government has undertaken schools and hospital construction projects. Thanks to the initial school infrastructure construction rehabilitation program from our own equity for the public treasury, as to date, more than 600 schools have been entirely built, equipped, and delivered through the national territory in less than 2 years. The objective is to the 1,000th school will be delivered during this year, and each tertiary of the 26 province, the country is eligible without discrimination. Of course, special care is given to the zones which are recovering from conflicts in the east of our country. In 2010, a development strategy for primary and high schools have been adopted by government. It is implemented in a framework of educational interim plan, which is endorsed in 2012 by the technical and financial partners. Ladies and gentlemen, macroeconomic stability and growth recovery do not have value to the people unless they improve the living conditions of the people. What was observed in the DRC? A remarkable poverty incidence and malnutrition drop, an increase of the purchase power of Congolese, but also a stagnation in job creation, particularly for the youth, as well as the persistent inequality. The per capita income has significantly increased, moving from 149 in 2001 to nearly 600 in 2015. The poverty incidence has dropped by a quarter, going from more than 80% in 1990 to 63.4% in 2012, and it is projected in 2020 to 40%. The Human Development Index published by the UNDP has dropped from 0.329 in 2000 to 4.423 in 2014. And the country is no more lagging in the world ranking. It has gained 11 places in 2015 Human Development Index published in 2016. After the 1990-2001 deterioration, the gross and net enrollment rate in primary education has respectively reached 98.4% and 90.5%. This rise testifies the improvement of Congolese education. The progress depends on the increase of budget allocation in favor of education and health sector, which moved from 2010 and 2014 from 9% to 16% and 1.4% to 7.3% respectively. You can see this on the table. Mr. Carlos Lopez, ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, what is the basis of the current success of the DRC? The lessons to be drawn from the work done over the past few years can be categorized in 7 points. First of all, the stabilization of macroeconomic framework is the outcome of a strong commitment through leadership and government led by the President of the Republic. Secondly, reforms are indispensable to enable the country to resume economic growth. This concerns the success, the survival of all African countries. Macroeconomic stability together with bold policies have made it possible for the DRC to increase. For your information, the DRC was ranked the third country to have received foreign direct investment in Africa in 2014. Thirdly, stability and economic growth bring in their work, poverty reduction, and resilience. Fourthly, investment in social sectors makes it possible to increase inclusive growth. Five, education is a key sector in which one must absolutely invest in order to awaken consciousness by increasing the literacy rate to guarantee the well-being of the future generations, to increase chances of benefit, the demographic dividend, and to prepare the youth to face the economy of knowledge. Six, peace and security are the cornerstone for economic stability. If you're not for the war, all things being equal, would have been around $3,500. The table before you clearly shows the negative impact of the war, but for the war, the RDC was on the path to growth, and our revenue would have been four times what we have today. Seven, and finally, we necessarily have to diversify the economy, especially through agricultural sector, which makes it possible to recuperate a large portion of the poor and to build national, which is needed, to build citizens which are needed in order to carry out serenely with public policies. Since 2010, treasury resources have come mainly from two sources. One, the mobilization of internal resources, which went up from 8% to 13% in 2015. And secondly, resources coming from debt alleviation. And thirdly, the improvement of institutional setup and also the quality of expenditure. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, before I conclude, let me talk about the bleak outlook of the international economy, which has been brought about by a decrease in commodity prices. And this has three impacts on African economy, on the national budget, on the market of goods and services, and also on the market of trading. And for example, cumulative fiscal policies from 2015 represent 75% of resources mobilized during the same period in 2015. The second impact relates to economic growth. And this international crisis led the DRC to attain a growth of 7%, whereas in 2015 it was 10.3%. The third effect on the offer of foreign exchange on the market, pressure on the market on the market, which led, which impacted on the Congolese franc over the past 3 months. You know very well that the macroeconomic framework of many African countries have been affected, have been impacted during the same period. It is within this framework that, to ensure the resilience of the DRC economy, the government has decided to cut down an expenditure of government institutions. Ladies and gentlemen, as you have observed, we remain convinced that the future of Africa is henceforth in our own hands, and we have to take this opportunity to ensure its development, its national unity, for the interest of African people and for the welfare of all of us. We should absolutely consolidate our macroeconomic framework, which is the basis of the future of the African continent, the future of the youth, and which would fuel the prosperity of the continent. Exactly 70 years ago, Jean-Paul Sartre said, "Man is nothing more than his project. He only exists as far as he achieves them." So he's nothing more than a totality of his actions, nothing more than his life. Let them, therefore, be courageous and build a better future for Africa and better for Africa. Thank you.
Excellent presentation. So my take home so far have been that we need to be bold. We need to understand, or we need to think through our own models. We know how to write our own models, we know how to own them, and we know how to execute them. So we need to be bold in terms of the models that we adopt. We also need a proper social contract. I think in the presentation of the report that that you're going to give, you mentioned a word called fiscal legitimacy, and I like that. It requires a return on investment by governments for its people. And also, as the Prime Minister mentioned, a diversification of fiscal receipts. There's too strong a dependency on trade and resource taxes, I believe you said in your foreword. There's a word that comes about, it's resilience. I think following the 2008-2009 financial crisis, African economies showed extreme resilience, and that was because of strong governance and macroeconomic management. And I think today, the new normal are exogenous shocks. I think we will see lower growth prospects, and the proof will be in how we react to them. and to see that we are, to show the world that we are resilient and that we have got the right economic policies to overcome these exogenous shocks. I believe in the report as well, or sorry, in your presentation, you show that the government has a clear stake and a clear role to play and can shift the curves in its favor. And you showed how it was done. And I think that I'm a free marketer, but I still believe in the strong role of government. And a good government, good governance, can have phenomenal outcomes on development issues, as you mentioned. It was quite interesting when you said, when you mentioned the 7 points, because there's a lot of overlap with what's said in this report, actually. So it's not just theory, but it's theory and practice coming together. But because I believe in your report, you mentioned that development macroeconomic policies are centered on three pillars. You mentioned human capacity, which is education. You also mentioned infrastructure, which is ultimately public investment that offers a return. And also institutions, which is all about governance, as we said. But anyway, I'm just an amateur, and I don't know much about these reports. However, the man on my right-hand side here, Adam, is the expert, and he'll tell you more about this report that they've put together. Please, Adam.
Thank you, Omar. Good afternoon. Good evening, Razer. Ladies and gentlemen, the report I'm going to present is very much in line with the key messages and recommendations presented by His Excellency, Prime Minister of DRC, and Dr. Carlos Lopez, Executive Secretary of ECA. This is a framework study targeting policymakers, and here we at ECA, we are working on also a more elaborate study that will target a wide audience, including researchers, academia, as well as policymakers. Indeed, the key message of this book is very much in line with what the Prime Minister has said. The orthodox
economy, la théorie orthodoxe de l'économie, cette théorie est en train de s'effondrer. La RDC a tout fait pour pouvoir baisser l'inflation et promouvoir la croissance en même temps. Et on a donc défini en tout cas les courbes économiques et tout en montrant des preuves qui sont conformes à l'analyse actuelle, qui montrent qu'il y a une sérieuse divergence entre les résultats économiques et les politiques mises en place.
This report starts with an introduction and articulate the case for structural transformation in Africa. Then the evolution of development policy frameworks since independence and macroeconomic policy in Africa's long-term development framework, and then looks at ingredients of macroeconomic policy, fiscal policies, then monetary and exchange rate policies. Continent rising. We have discussed this. Africa is now changing, true, but a lot has to be changed in terms of development models. Africa has plenty full natural resource endowments, and Africa is slowly diversifying, but steadily. And we must acknowledge that, thanks mainly to improving economic management and improvements in governance in general. Yet economic diversification and structural transformation remains limited compared to Africa's potential and Africa's needs to promote employment and poverty reduction. Africa needs to diversify further into high productivity sectors, into manufacturing in particular, and promote industrialization. This is the objective of Africa as articulated by ECA and as it has informed ECA work over the last few years and will continue to inform ECA work moving forward. So structural transformation is a must. And the goal is to build resilient economies that can withstand shocks and that will provide employment and promote value addition that will lead to increased income and resilience over the long run. Structural transformation processes in Africa, very briefly, as described in the book, must involve productive investment within sector and shifting resources to higher value-added activities, regional integration for enlarging to enlarge markets and promote competitiveness regionally and globally, creating opportunities for all Africans, and upgrading physical and human productive assets, learning by doing, enhancing skills, and upgrading comparative advantage by moving into more competitive areas and competitive advantages. Adopting green technology for sustainable development will be one of the processes for Africa to promote resilience and transformation. The building blocks of Africa's structural transformation include investing in human development, investing in infrastructure, institutional transformation by creating an institutional configuration for productive public-private partnership. And doing all that requires a development planning framework. The book talks about Africa's experience with development planning in the 1960s, 1970s, and then the lost decades of structural adjustments of the 1980s and 1990s, and the changing economic landscape since the 2000s, and the realization for African governments to do more to address market failures, and the realization that Africa's transformation and development cannot be left to the market because of pervasive market failures, which you all know. So macroeconomic policy and the long-term development strategy plays a critical role in terms of not just stabilization, but promotion of long-term development, investment, growth, and so on. So we need to have a comprehensive development plan, and then sectoral development policies related to trade, technology, education, health, social, finance, industry, agriculture, and all other sectors. These are the building blocks for Africa's structural transformation. To do that, Africa needs macroeconomic policy to identify its macroeconomic policy priorities in terms of scaling up public investment and public goods provision, maintain macroeconomic stability, coordinate public investment and development policies, mobilize resources, and secure fiscal sustainability based on fiscal legitimacy. To do all that, we need a development financing framework. And Africa was able to articulate its priorities for financing for development through the Addis Ababa Action Agenda on Financing Development, adopted in the third conference on financing for development held here in Addis Ababa last year. And moving forward, Africa has already identified its development priorities, but needs to do more to mobilize domestic resources. Increasingly, financing Africa's priorities will rely on domestic resources. And the book identifies the policies, fiscal and monetary policies, that can be used to support African governments' efforts to mobilize resources to finance their development moving forward. I don't want to take much time, but the key fiscal policies will aim at establishing fiscal legitimacy, primarily through high-quality public goods and services provision and improved public resource management, and turning natural resource wealth into productive assets. The minister, His Excellency Prime Minister, gave us examples from DRC, and managing public finance and sovereign debt sustainably through counter-cyclical policies also mentioned by His Excellency. And finally, fighting illicit financial flows. Also, His Excellency alluded to some of the issues related to mining in DRC, but this is a common issue across many African countries. Key monetary and related policies will aim at promoting both stabilization and long-term development, with a focus on building institutions such as development finance, development banks that will support investment in Africa, and that will help efforts by African countries to bridge the link between finance and real economic activity. So monetary policy should be based on careful evaluation of inflationary trends and development needs, rather than standardized policy prescriptions that come from outside Africa. And monetary policy should also be based on appropriate exchange rate regimes and manage cross-border capital flows. Very often, we have seen countries complacent when it comes to exchange rate policy, maintaining overvalued exchange rate policies just because they have oil reserves. This is very damaging to private investment, very damaging to diversification, and very damaging to promotion of structural transformation in Africa. So overvaluation is bad. Also, undervaluation could be bad if you do not have strong supply side instruments. Mobilizing resources is also emphasized, but we need to reappraise conventional monetary policy stance in order to strike a better balance that will promote Africa's structural transformation. These are the key highlights of the key messages and policy recommendations of the book. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Adam. We started a bit late, but I think we've got about another half hour. So we'll hear from our respondents, our panelists, and then maybe we'll take a few statements or comments or questions from the audience. I was going to start with you, Dr. Niwai, but as Adam finished on monetary policy, exchange rate policy, inflation targeting, I'm going to have to put you on the spot, Nagla. In terms of, obviously, you can talk about the Egypt experience. I think that there was a slight devaluation a couple of weeks ago. And obviously, in terms of going from inflation targeting to output targeting, which Dr. Lopez mentioned, and general monetary policy, your thoughts on what's been said and the Egypt case.
Thank you. I would like to express my appreciation for this honor opportunity that I have and to hear a complete success story from Congo, because success story, if it isn't ended with poverty reduction, it is not a story. Concerning the report, I think the report have shed the spotlight for two main sources of the main source of what happened in Africa. Slowly diversification, domestic resource. This is the two main factors that tell the story of Africa. First of all, I would like to give something before I begin with the Egyptian story. Slowly, the diversification all with Africa is a phase of external shocks, whatever, negative or positive. For commodity prices, when increase, this is a positive shocks. It followed with expansion fiscal policy, inflation, and a problem with monetary policy. And when it is negative shocks, it end with devaluation of the currency. Foreign reserve couldn't support the price of the domestic currency, and turning to the point to trade off, keep foreign reserve or leave the change, the currency is devaluation. So this is the main problem for the whole story. In Africa, in general, if we made a growth, it's not the secret of success. Inclusive growth is the secret of success. The problem is, if I make a growth rate, whatever it was, even it was 20%, and this growth rate doesn't reach to the village, to the people, this is not a growth. The main problem with Africa is urbanization. People leave the village and go to the city, try to find out work, trying to find out more service. This put more pleasure for the government. So they leave their main work, how to prepare or find the agriculture which make food sufficient for the people. So this is the main problem. If we have an idea or vision for the growth, I think the main pillar for our success for Africa is SMEs. SMEs, if we, this will fight unemployment, make diversification, and make high level of standard, and make value added. And we have a success story of businessmen association in Alexandria. They succeeded in make SMEs and finance about $6 billion to the youth people. This story is very successful, and it's helped people. They make a campaign and began to discuss with the youth people, what do you think about your project? What is your skills? And after that, maybe this man came out changing his idea according to the people who's very close to him, and find out for him the way by negotiation, by being close to them. So this is he gets the feeling that he's part of the society. He's not something apart from it. For Egypt, for what we have, the problem with Egypt, it's not positive or negative checks. The problem with Egypt was political instability. The fundamental was good, and the problem was this transition period. Growth rate before 2011 was 7% annual. Now it's beginning to recovery. It reached to 2.1, now it's began to 4.2, and we hope that it's going to increase. But what we have, it's import, as all the African countries make a high contribution of GDP. So what make the monetary policy face problem? It has to find the foreign currency for import, for debt sustainability, and for payment debt service. Thank God for Egypt, is our external debt, it's not that much, it's only 16% of GDP, which is so good. But in other way, our export-import ratio, it's now 33% because of the price of petrol. So diversification is much important, but you have to be, monetary policy have to be flexible with what happened. We have came to the pro-cycle, pro-act in inflation, and although there was an domestic debt, high domestic debt, but we increase the interest rate because we always keep an eye for the depositor. So they have to have the right to have a positive interest rate. Financial institution, credibility of financial institution is very, very, very important because people, when they feel safe with banks, they put their money there. For another success story for Egypt for finance its investment project, it was Suez Canal. And at that time, it was very difficult for Egypt to borrow from outside because risk premium, for sure, it will be high. And you need to invest your national project. What the central bank done, he think about making a certificate for Suez Canal, and he make it with a different amount, beginning with 10 piastres, this means 10 pound, Egyptian pound, this means less than $1, to 1,000, you can buy. And he succeeded to attract 64 billion Egyptian pound, this means 9 billion US dollar in 7 days, which 4 billion dollars came outside the banking system. He succeeded to finance the Suez Canal project and succeeded to finalize it in 1 year. This is make credibility. Within this story, he succeeded in doing financial inclusion because he used post office, which is all over Egypt, and in a small village, and encourage student to buy a certificate to begin to save. And at the same time, prerequisite to buy this certificate to open an account in the banks. So he make a public investment, financial inclusion, and the behavior of the student of saving. This is how the country can manage its local resource to face or to resilient against the wind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nagla. Yes, that was a great example of domestic resource mobilization and finding internal solutions to our problems. Or not, it's not even a problem, really. It's an opportunity. Dr. Niwai, economic diversification is at the center of Ethiopian economic policy. So we, Adam mentioned comparative advantage. We've heard about productivity. What is, where is Ethiopia's comparative advantage? What are you doing in terms of economic diversification and being internationally competitive?
Thank you. I will respond to that question in the framework of a slightly expanded intervention. My intervention revolves around two questions. Question number one, what is it that we want from macroeconomic management? Very briefly, and I shall try to explore a bit more, we want from macroeconomic management, one, for it to contribute to growth of savings, ultimately capital. Second, to maintain stable real exchange rate. Question number two, what is the consistency between macro policy and development strategy? And how may this be attained? Quite important. It should be governed by development. A development strategy. technology becomes essential if we want to have fast economic growth. Otherwise, we can leave it to the market. And if we want broad-based growth, I think the way to ensure inclusiveness is through the growth process itself, and hence the importance of broad-based growth. So let me come back very briefly to the first question, which is about maintaining growth of savings and capital, and what might be the role of macroeconomic policy. Now, normally, when we think about the policy variable that we have to enable us to increase savings is one which revolves around interest rates. Is it possible to adjust interest rates so that we can have greater savings, so that we can encourage greater savings? And the general conclusion that has been reached is that savings tends to be rather insensitive to increases in interest rate, which is to say, if you increase interest rate, you might not end up by increasing savings as much as you want. Paradoxically, however, if your interest rate in real terms is negative, to which Madame was referring, then obviously you can decrease savings. So it's not symmetrical. It's very important that you have an interest rate that is near enough to being positive. I say near enough to being positive because there are examples which show that a slightly repressed interest rate could serve purposes of growth by reducing the lending rate on the investment side. How about fiscal space? Excellency, in your presentation, you clearly showed that in DRC it was possible to increase taxation or to streamline taxation, increase government revenue, and through that process, in fact, have a growth trajectory which is dependent on public investment and agricultural-led growth, which is excellent. Suppose you've done that, which is you've increased taxation and then obtained revenue as much as you want, and you still want government to be able to bring about investment in infrastructure, etc., and contribute to growth. And that is where the question of fiscal space comes in. Recent literature among economists has made a slight improvement here by way of recognizing the possibility of increasing money supply above what is required for actual growth rate, because there is divergence between the actual and the potential growth rate. So if you think that you can achieve faster growth through a slightly expanded monetary policy, it is conceivable that this can bring about result. But one has to be pretty careful in the manner in which this is deployed. What I am saying is, do it, but cautiously. Let me move to exchange rate. Adam has been referring to the risk of overvaluation. It is a risk that we have observed in many countries and tends to be a bit greater in situations where countries depend on primary products, and particularly minerals and oil, but that needs closer attention. It is important that exchange rate in real terms remains stable so that you can then have a competitiveness in international trade. So to maintain our comparative advantage in engaging in exports, not simply of agriculture, but also manufacturing products, and hence transformation, it is essential that we have an exchange rate which is more or less stable in real terms. You did ask me about the Ethiopian experience, and let me briefly mention that. In the case of Ethiopia, what we have tried is, in the first instance, to draw a long-term development strategy. In our case, because we are a least developed country, we do not have minerals, we don't have anything else, it is pretty clear that what you need is to develop agriculture. So this is a development strategy which says, develop agriculture first, and then move to industrialization. And to be able to develop agriculture first, there are a few things which are very important. In particular, it is important to make credit, bank credit, accessible to farmers at an affordable rate. And that leads you to what? It leads you to a stance, a policy stance, where you would need to have, you would need not to deregulate the financial market. The financial market, in other words, must be kept under leash so that you are able to come up with lending rates that are affordable to your farmers. If you have that, then it is possible that by providing credit and enabling farmers to buy fertilizer, etc., they can increase their output. And round one of your development strategy, i.e. agricultural development, becomes conceivable. The other thing that we did, as we moved along with agricultural growth, is to put heavy emphasis on infrastructure development. Because ultimately, well, both for agriculture and also for industrialization, you need energy, you need efficient transport, you need water supply, the whole works. And to be able to do that, again, the question of fiscal space becomes important. I think this might respond to your question. Thank you.
Yao, your thoughts.
Thank you. Your Excellency, the Prime Minister of DRC, Your Excellency, Dr. Carlos Lopez, Head of ECA, fellow panelists, and distinguished audience. First, I'd like to congratulate the Prime Minister for the excellent work that they've done in DRC and for his excellent presentation here. And also thank ECA for the invitation and congratulate them for this excellent report on a very important topic. The report, as I read the report, the main tenet is that for transformation, the macroeconomic framework needs to go beyond just stabilization. This is a position that I wholeheartedly agree with. The question is how? In many African countries, really, the macro framework really revolves around the fiscal stance. And by that, I mean, the macro really determines, in addition to what fiscal finances, determines the availability and price of credit. Exchange rate there are other important considerations, but I'm not going to go in there. I think what Dr. Nawai has said suffices. But so I'll focus basically on the fiscal policy for activist fiscal policy for transformation. Yes, we need to go beyond stabilization. First, there's the whole traditional area of public goods. And there's a huge unfinished agenda there in infrastructure, education, health, not to mention peace and security. So there's a lot of investment required. And beyond that, in transformation, we just talked about industrial policy, in many of these things from Professor Chong and the session before. Industrial policy requires that the government becomes, in a sense, a venture financier. In non-diplomatic language, call it picking winners. You need to be able to finance some initiatives that you think are going to help you in your diversification, market expansion, technology upgrading, and things like that. Completing the unfinished agenda in the public goods requires huge resources. Doing the industrial policy financing, the venture capitalism, requires a bit of discretion in terms of who you pick and what you finance. And so this really calls into question, how do we ensure that as we move into an activist macro stance for transformation? So let me back out. And in the previous session, somebody made a remark, I thought was Celestine, that deficits, fiscal deficits, are not necessarily bad. It depends on what they finance, whether they allow you to pay back. If they do, it's good. So as we move into activist fiscal policy, how do we make sure that what we actually finance economic transformation rather than lead us to economic collapse, that leads us back into the IMF and structural adjustment programs? In fact, don't forget that Africa ended up with structural adjustment programs in the 1980s, beginning in the 1980s, precisely because of macroeconomic collapse. Also, in my own country, Ghana, after graduating from two decades of IMF programs at the beginning of 2000, we were back to the IMF within a decade. And this after also discovering oil that added the resources. So to me, the question of how do you ensure that within an activist fiscal framework, you actually have the institutions to ensure that the resources go to the right place and they are applied efficiently so that you get the resources that you want. I think that should be more and more as we go forward, the debate over whether or not we should listen to the IMF or the World Bank and the programs. I think we've had that enough of that. The question is that we need to move forward. We need to be more activists. We need to pursue transformation. The question is how? Do we have the institutional framework for it? And very quickly, for example, on the management of public investment. First, countries have to have clear transformation strategies. And in fact, we were in Kigali about 2 weeks ago, and His Excellency Kagame came and gave a lecture. And he talked to us, and he said, a strategy is not a wish list. A wish list is just a recipe for endless conferences and declarations. A strategy has to be very clear-eyed and very realistic in terms of what you, it has to be ambitious, but realistic. Second, once you have your realistic strategy, do the investment that are entailed in this activist fiscal policy really correspond to the strategy that has been laid, or are they dictated by political whims or whatever? You need to make sure that, the very reason why we are where we are is that we are very poor Therefore, we cannot afford to waste our resources. So that every penny that we have has to go to, we have to get the most bang for the buck. Do we have the institutional structures that actually select what we finance, appraise them in a professional manner, and provide a proper monitoring? And when, in fact, it is found that resources haven't gone the way they, where they're supposed to go, or haven't been applied efficiently, do we have the courage and the mechanisms to actually take action against people involved? These are all practical questions that many African countries are dealing with now. And on I think until we really are able to, and I mean, ironically, about 20 or 30 years ago, many African countries had better investment management selection and appraisal system than they do now. So as we go into transformation and trying to really get into more activist fiscal policy, it is imperative, not only that we bring the plan back, which I think ECA is really leading and is admirable, strengthening the institutional capacity for public investment is absolutely critical. Because if people know that their money that the government is collecting is going to projects that they can see, then as the report says, you have the legitimacy to correct more tax. All these talks about increasing domestic resource mobilization won't amount to much if people feel that the money that they're giving to the government is not accounted for. I can tell you many people in my country, Ghana, feel that already they are overtaxed. So the idea that you're going to raise domestic resources by taxing them more is a non-starter. The only way you're going to get that is people really feel increasingly that the money that is being taken by government is really going to good users and they are benefiting. So to me, the whole idea of the fiscal framework, more macro framework for transformation revolves around making sure that we have institutional framework to make sure that resources are used properly and are reported properly to the citizens, and then there's accountability. Thank you.
Thank you, Yao. I thought I told you that in an election year, you're not allowed to criticize your government in a neutral platform. I'm just teasing you.
I criticize my government. Not my government. Statements I've made cast across.
I'm just teasing you. Okay, so we've got 10 minutes for interventions from the floor or questions that you may want to ask the panelists. If you could please introduce yourself and keep it short. We'll start with the gentleman.
Monsieur le Premier ministre, Monsieur le secrétaire exécutif, je voudrais vraiment vous exprimer ma haute satisfaction parce que je comprends votre problème en tant que technocrate, en tant qu'expert, de fonctionner dans un milieu politique où toute décision économique est en fait un rapport de force. J'apprécie donc ça hautement. Deuxièmement, je vous remercie de nous avoir donné une leçon pour la première fois peut-être de ma vie en tant qu'économiste. J'ai une explication in vivo d'un succès de politique de stabilisation qui exige bien sûr un courage exceptionnel et c'est ce que j'ai vu d'une manière systématique. Pour ces deux raisons, Monsieur le Premier ministre, je vous remercie de votre présentation. Le problème évidemment commence avec ce qu'a dit notre collègue de l'Éthiopie dont je ne vois pas très bien le nom et qui a été confirmé par notre collègue de la Guinée, du Ghana. La stabilisation est là, Monsieur le Premier ministre. Il est clair que cela a entraîné une croissance économique extensive, assez élevée, selon les chiffres, mais qui, de mon point de vue, auront tendance à taper down, en tous les cas qui sont financés essentiellement, bien sûr, par les ressources naturelles, les services et les transports d'une manière générale. Donc il faut passer au second stade. Le second stade, c'est celui de la diversification que vous avez noté vous-même, Monsieur le Premier ministre. Et cette diversification, c'est là la transformation. Le problème de la transformation, comme le disait d'ailleurs notre collègue de la CEA, est lié non pas au problème de la stabilisation, mais au problème de la transformation du système économique en tant que tel. Et cela entraîne bien sûr un certain nombre de mesures qui sont des mesures qui peuvent être mises dans un plan, mais qui touchent carrément aux banques, qui touchent au problème de la promotion des SME, qui touchent au problème du marché lui-même, étant donné le problème de l'informel, qui touche un certain nombre de problèmes, donc techniquement, qui doivent être pris en compte et qui ne sont pas faciles à résoudre, notamment quand il s'agit d'avoir en même temps l'investissement direct étranger et promouvoir les SMI, les PME nationales, si on veut aller. Ce matin, nous étions en train de discuter, nous avons assisté à une présentation magnifique du professeur Chang dans les lectures des DDG, et il nous a dit ce qu'il fallait faire et ce qu'il ne fallait peut-être pas faire comme politique. Le problème est qu'il s'est arrêté à ce qui a été quelles sont les mesures que nous devons faire, quelles sont les politiques. Ces politiques, c'est évidemment la transformation, etc. Mais un immense problème...
How do we get a proper policy to fit it in? But how is it going to be done? Because we have serious problems of governance, and there's this permanent balance of power, as it were, in the political atmosphere. So, and that is why, Honorable Prime Minister, your courage in trying to deal with this matter technically is quite commendable. So, it's not only what should be done, but how it should be done when we have to deal with matters of governance. And I'm extremely pleased that the ECA has now started raising, in very crude manner, but in an effective way, how we can resolve this problem so that we start having a policy that is absolutely rational and achievable on the ground. Thank you, Honorable Prime Minister. Is the Honorable Prime Minister, your success is that of Africa as a whole, and we're highly impressed. And now we will understand what you've done. If you allow me, Honorable Prime Minister, I have a number of questions for you. First, what are the accompanying measures? What would you expect from international funding agencies, who are your partners? You've made a lot of effort. Do you expect the international financial institutions to contribute in what manner, for instance? I have two other minor questions. One is in connection with the tax pressure. I see there's been an increase of fiscal pressure. Is there a slowdown, or is it due to an increase in the tax rate? The other question is in connection with the point raised earlier by His Excellency Mr. Neward, in connection with the interest rate, in order to mobilize domestic savings, well, we tend to raise the interest rate, and it adversely affects the increase in private investment. What was your choice in this respect, Honorable Prime Minister? My name is Bukar Mbake. I'm a journalist. I am the director of Itinerance. My question is intended for Mr. Carlos Lopez. It's been some time since you've been following this whole process of industrial development. I would like to know whether you've carried out any assessment, any evaluation, following all these documents and meetings that you have held in connection with that industrial development policy. The second question is to the Prime Minister of the DRC, which is a country I go to quite often. In 2014, sir, I met you during the Francophone Forum for Women. I asked to have an interview with you. I didn't succeed in securing the interview. Now, quite a sizable number of the Congolese population is quite young. Do you have an appropriate strategy, some policy to deal with this young population, particularly within the context of industrialization? My last question is in regard to Congo Airways. It has moved. How about its sustainability? How durable is it going to be? Thank you. So, Honorable Prime Minister, let's move. Thank you very much for all the questions raised here. I would like, firstly, to acknowledge the relevance of the points that have been raised by the speakers that took the floor earlier. That's in connection with the whole issue of governance and leadership and how it is related to the transformation of various economies. You talked about the transformation of economic systems. Today, Africa is viewed as the continent of the future simply because the methods of management have completely changed. The type of leadership, the type of governance has changed. And that's most important, as you quite rightly stated. And we needed to say so because the economic growth of the DRC, the inclusive approach in the growth phenomenon, which has had an impact on the standard of living of the people. There has been a significant decrease in poverty. I wanted to say that there's a certain vision that has been projected by the President of the Republic, President Kabila. And that vision aims at transforming or amending or modifying the method of management, the method of governance, so that the proceeds emanating from management could be distributed fairly. So I did appreciate the statement made by our colleague from Ghana, who talked about the whole problem of institutions, the international institutions, multilateral relationships. And in fact, I would be referring later on to the comment made by the boss of Baleia. You see, there has to be this determination on the part of African countries to be masters of their own destiny. They have to determine what path to follow and to apply the same method of management as the one applied by the developed countries. We don't need to have the fight against fraud, corruption. It doesn't need to be imposed on us. We need to pursue it or prosecute it on our own. We have to know that good governance is absolutely necessary for all of us. The effective utilization of public funds on behalf of our people. Growth should not be shared only by a small group of individuals. So that is what we're trying. For instance, when we invest in roads, when we invest in public administration, when we invest in the area of education, in health, it is indeed to enable the majority of the population to derive some benefit from that growth. And therefore, the method of management would need to change. Governance would be an absolute necessity. Justice must be delivered so as to ensure that there is transformation over time. The agricultural sector, for instance, it is inadmissible that Africa would be importing food, because Africa does have all the required potential to be able to farm, produce, and export. How can we be exporting? How can we be importing rice, which we can produce on our own and even export? So, as you quite rightly stated, what have African countries, or what should African countries expect from multilateral institutions? Now, based on this growth, on this progress that is being noted today among African countries, and I said in Dakar, we were together in Dakar when our friend Adesina, for whom I have lots of esteem, was trying to check on the path to be followed by the African countries towards growth. It would be important for African institutions, these multilateral institutions or African international institutions, to accompany African countries. Like, for instance, if you have a project that is sponsored by the World Bank, ADB or Baleia, why would it take 3 years before disbursement starts? There cannot be development. Of course, I did not participate in the submission by the Harvard professor, but Carlos did give me the substance, as it were, of this said professor's submission. I think it is necessary for development institutions to understand the urgency that is necessary so that Africa can move forward. The red tape, the bureaucracy of these development institutions, that should not be an impediment to the progress of African countries. Of course, we have to strike a balance between urgency and development, or so poor management should not be any excuse. But we have all agreed that there has been an improvement. Let me give you an example. We are setting up an agri industry in Kinshasa. We are using or contributing public funds, more than $100 million, something like 80 hectares. We want to have this agri industry. None of the development institutions gave us a single dollar. The multilateral institution said, oh, they just said, it is impressive. It is very well done, properly selected. We have to support you. But these are merely expressions of interest or intention. But we don't build anything with mere speeches, statements, or papers. It is real support that we expect from the multilateral institutions. And you are the bosses, for instance, in the case of the Abra Bank for Development. So what have we done to broaden the fiscal space? Has there been an increase in the rate? Has there been an increase in the interest rate? Let me say this. We have made a lot of reforms, particularly in the taxation field. For instance, we have set up this value-added tax because our system was too archaic. It didn't allow us to gather or to collect enough taxes. So with the VAT, we were able to broaden this tax assessment, get these economic operators or businessmen to become involved. You know, when the taxes are too much, too burdensome, they actually spell the doom of taxation. Finally, this question from my friend from the Itinerance newspaper, is there a policy for the youth? Of course there is. We have to help the youth by way of education. For the very first time under the leadership of President Kabila, education is a real and genuine priority. 4%. From 4%, we moved on to 16% of the budget, which is devoted or allocated to education. We have 3 million children who are not going to school and who are now going to school. So we triple this. I mean, that is about three times what the population of certain African countries. When you have 3 million souls saved, you preempt progress of your country. We have also made investments in the free primary education in our country. We have also built schools. Using public funds, in 2 years, we have built 600 schools, and we spent some more than $150 million. I was responsible for an agency for the execution of projects financed by various multilateral institutions. So to build 600 schools with these multilateral institutions, may take you 20 years, but we did it in 2 years. So we intend to work with the youth by investing in education, agriculture, so that the youth can take over and transform the agricultural sector. In conclusion, Congo Airways, again, that's a product of good governance and proper leadership. We have a major company, Air Zaire it was called. It went bankrupt because of poor governance, poor management. Now, with the proceeds from proper management, we set up Congo Airways, which has already started with several Airbus planes. We have something like, we spent something in the neighborhood of $16 million, and we bought a new plane not too long ago. So we want to launch this company. First, based on public funds, and in the not-too-distant future, we'll open up the share capital to the private sector so that the private sector can become involved, and so the method of management would be a lot more efficient, a lot more effective, so that this company can become one of the best on the continent, because this company doesn't need only three or four companies. It needs several, many more companies. Thank you, Honorable Prime Minister, for that very specific and detailed, as well as honest answer, which is not always the case. It was very detailed, and we thank you. Dr. Lopez,
close the session, and then I'll ask all our panelists to officially launch the report for a photo that will be able to tell the world that this report is now available online.
Thank you, Omar. Of course, concluding remarks will be at this extreme hour difficult. Everybody is, of course, very tired, but also very satisfied, I think, because we had an excellent presentation, fantastic session, not only in terms of information, but also in terms of, you know, opening the minds for the transformation project that we are all involved with. The question that was asked is actually quite appropriate for me to answer. For much more stronger, bolder industrial policy in the continent. And the answer is we have been doing that for the last 4 years. This is our bread and butter. We have first started with a report, economic report on industrialization through commodities, how we could use commodities as the entry point. Then we did a report on industrial policy, how we could really learn the lessons of the 70s and not make the same mistakes today when we deal with industrial policy. Then we looked into the relationship between industrialization and trade, which was the subject of last year's report. And this year, we are publishing three very important contributions. The one that has just been presented on the relationship between macroeconomic policy framework and our drive towards transformation and industrialization, but also a report on greening Africa's industrialization, because we believe Africa can leapfrog in many respects the difficulties that others will have in retrofitting by making sure that we take full advantage of some of the very good megatrends in our favor, including the fact that right now the costs of renewable energy match the cost of producing fossil fuel generated electricity. So we really can benefit from that. And of course, the transformative industrial policy report that was the subject of not only a lecture this morning by Professor Ajun Chang, he was the lead author in that report, but also was combined with the presentations of this afternoon. I must say that we have also indirectly benefited from the assessments that have been done on industrialization in Africa by many other authors. This has become now a topic that is quite popular. We have the contribution from Arkebe Okubai from Ethiopia with his book Made in Africa that was also introduced this afternoon. We have very important contributions coming from our colleagues at UNIDO, led by Celestin Monga. He is also amongst us. And we are also benefiting from the works that have been done by ASET, and Yao is here. So we have a coalition of people looking into these matters, and I hope that it has been a coalition strong enough to convince the skeptics that really this is the way to go. And I'm going to finish with something that I heard yesterday where, as I was talking with Mo Aboudou. For those who know, she's quite a star in Africa, has a huge following. Some people say it's the African Oprah Winfrey. And she's also here because she's part of the dialogue that we are having with the media. And, you know, Omar is also very active on this dialogue, because we believe that media has to contribute to changing the narrative about Africa. But the reason I'm bringing Mo into the picture is because she told me that she decided just to do something completely crazy, which was to pick up a microphone, go into Trafalgar Square in London, and stop people and ask just one question, and, you know, record all of this. And the question was, what is the first thing that you think when I say Africa? And then she heard the most incredible number of adjectives and definitions and concepts about Africa, from poverty, you can imagine, no? From poverty, disease, conflict, all the way to some patronizing adjectives also that, you know, dancing, people that laugh a lot, and I don't know what. And she was quite amazed that nobody had really much to say of importance about what is happening in the continent, what should be the narrative about the continent at this time and age. And she concluded, you know, as she was telling me the story, that the best she heard was sunshine. So let's have sunshine. Thank you.
Thank you. If you could have a group photo of the report, please, that would be great.
Absolument. Je suis tout à fait d'accord.
Faut prendre le rapport, non, le rapport. On va juste faire une photo avec le rapport.
Avec le rapport, on va prendre une photo.
Voilà.
OK.